During the World Wars, the submarine came into maturation as a weapon system. By the end of the Second World War, German U-boats had sunk around 3,500 merchant vessels, while American submarines had destroyed somewhere around 60% of the Japanese merchant fleet and 30% of the Japanese Navy. At the time, one of the primary purposes of the submarine was to take out the enemy merchant fleet, as part of putting the squeeze on the enemy's economy, and hence, severely hurting their warfighting capabilities. However, in modern combat, purposely targeting civilians has become taboo. Additionally, there are only a handful of navies on the planet capable of going toe-to-toe with the United States that would justify large numbers of these expensive weapon systems.
Why does the United States Navy continue to invest billions of dollars in large submarines? Hi, I'm Jacob Katz, and over the course of this video, I will guide you through the submarine's post-World War II history. We'll go over some of the evolution of technology and tactics that have kept and will keep the submarine a vital part of the United States military's arsenal.
Our story begins in World War II, with Germany lacking a heavy bomber capable of striking America, which was the heart of the Allied war machine. It was planned to have a U-boat tow a submersible barge across the Atlantic to a point off the East Coast. Once there, the barge would be surfaced and would then fire off a number of V-2 rockets at an American city, such as New York. Thankfully, however, Germany surrendered before the plan could be carried out, but the idea was not lost to the dustbin of history. After the war, new ways of delivering the newly developed nuclear bomb were explored, placing a nuke on a missile descended from the V-2 rocket and having it being launched from submarines was highly appealing for a number of reasons. At the time, the only way to defend against the V-2 missile was to hit the launch site before the V-2 was fired. Even today, shooting down a ballistic missile is extremely hard. As such, ballistic missiles make an excellent delivery system for a nuclear warhead. The second reason, and most critical, is the fact that submarines are, by nature, incredibly hard to find. A submarine can lurk off a nation's coast for weeks on end without being detected, especially with the advent of nuclear power. As demonstrated by the first nuclear-powered submarine, the USS Nautilus, a nuclear-powered submarine can remain submerged for an indefinite amount of time, limited only by the amount of supplies it can carry for its crew. Non-nuclear submarines have to surface or snorkel near the surface to recharge their batteries, thus exposing themselves to possible detection and destruction. As such, a nuclear-powered and armed submarine, nicknamed Boomer, poses a deadly threat to any belligerent nation. The first Boomers were diesel-powered and only carried less than a handful of nuclear-armed missiles, such as the American Greyback class and the Soviet Zulu 5 class. Furthermore, they had to surface to fire their deadly payloads and had to be extremely close to their targets. The launch sequence itself could take several crucial minutes, in which the Boomer could be detected and destroyed before getting off a single shot. However, in 1959, the United States launched the George Washington class, armed with 16 Polaris ballistic missiles, each tipped with up to 3 warheads. The George Washington class is, by far, the first of the modern Boomer design for one simple reason. The missiles were housed in a vertical tube inside the hull of the submarine. They were ejected via pressurized gas, which then launched the missile to the surface. As soon as it surfaced, the rocket motor fired and the missile was on its way. That innovative launch system, which allowed missiles to be fired from underwater, made the Boomer the ultimate nuclear weapon delivery system. Land-based bomber and missile bases can be easily watched by potential enemies, and in times of war, easily taken out. But a nuclear-powered Boomer, lurking underwater for months at a time and carrying enough nuclear firepower to devastate an entire nation, is not so easy to find, let alone hit if the Boomer patrols in areas protected by friendly forces. But while one nation will have their own Boomers, other nuclear armed nations will have theirs as well. And there's a saying, catch a thief, use it. But in our case, catch a submarine, use a submarine. And that is one of the primary purposes of the attack submarine, to hunt down and take out other submarines. Either Boomers or other attack submarines, they get the job done much better than surface and airborne forces. An attack submarine, having located an enemy submarine, can, according to the situation, trail the target without being detected, and if war were declared, take out the opposing submarine fast. The same should be held true against surface ships. As mentioned earlier, the United States Navy's submarine force took out 30% of the Japanese Navy during the Second World War, and it's why so many of the world's navies operate attack submarines. With the introduction of land attack cruise missiles and anti-ship missiles, the submarine's job is enhanced, allowing distant surprise attacks. In fact, the primary weapon of the guided missile submarine are cruise missiles, with the Ohio class carrying upwards of 144 Tomahawk cruise missiles. But the stealthy nature of the submarine allows it to perform other jobs aside from launching missiles and hunting other ships and submarines. Listening in on enemy transmissions and tapping undersea cables are just a couple of examples. Others include laying mines at sea and delivering special forces soldiers onto hostile shores undetected. In fact, the primary delivery method preferred by the famed United States Navy SEAL are from submarines. It is for these reasons that submarines will continue to play a crucial role in any seagoing nation's arsenal. And what is the future? Your guess is as good as mine.